Hey, you're welcome, welcome, welcome to my channel. If you're watching on Facebook, can you hear me? If you're watching on YouTube, can you hear me? You can post in the comment section whether you can hear me or not. You're welcome, 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 welcome. It is a privilege. I'm happy to see you guys online. If you are watching on the replay, and if this is your first time, this is Femi's Place. My name is Femi Ayodele, and on Femi's Place on my channel, I talk about life issues, I discuss current issues, I use people's experiences, my experience, and I sometimes make references to the Bible, all with the aim of inspiring and encouraging us to becoming the best version of ourselves. So if this is your first time joining me, you can give this video on a big thumbs up and set up your notification so you can be notified whenever I upload new videos. So you are welcome, welcome, welcome. Can you see me? If you can see me, please let me know. If you can see me, please let me know. You're welcome. So today, what we are discussing here is lessons we can draw from the Ikoyi building collapse. Lessons we can draw from the Ikoyi building collapse. Hi, Mr. Samuel Temitope, I see you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your comments. I see you. So today we'll just be talking about lessons that we can, you know, we can actually draw from the Ikoyi building collapse. And I would also love to have your comments as well as we go along. So I have put quite a number. I had to look at the scenario and I put quite a number of lessons that I learned. And if there are other lessons that you have learned also, please share it. I will also flag it as we go ahead. So we are all aware of the Ikoyi building collapse. And the businessman that, you know, was the owner of the building, was in charge of the whole thing, was Mr. Femi Osibana. And it's been in the news that so many people have died, and stories coming from it says that, you know, the materials that were used were not the right materials to be used. And a lot of other issues came up. So I don't want to go into details. You can actually go online and type in Ikoyi building collapse and you get the full gist. But not to waste your time, I just came here to talk about what the lessons are. What have we learned? What did I came to share what I learned, and this is an opportunity for you to also share what you learned. And if you feel that this video is going to help a lot of other people, please do share, subscribe, share, and, you know, let other people learn. A lot of businesses need to learn from this. A lot of individuals need to learn from this. Even families need to learn. Small business owners, we need to learn from this. So the first thing that I take from here is make excellence your watchword. That's the first thing. Make excellence your watchword. Whether you are a businessman, whether you are a student, whether you are a mother, you are a father, whoever you are, wherever you are operating, whether you are an employee, make excellence your watchword. Now, I mean, if excellence was the watchword of every person, every stakeholder working on this project, if excellence was their watchword, this wouldn't have happened. They wouldn't have tried to cut corners. They wouldn't have used, you know, raw materials that were substandard. They would have just stuck to what the plan was and used the best. They would have used the best materials. If excellence is your watchword, there are so many things that you would not do. You will not cut corners. If excellence is your watchword, you will use the right raw materials for your job. That is the number one learning. You will use the right raw materials for your job. You will never, ever prioritize profit. Do not prioritize profit over excellence. I say that because really, money isn't everything. Money isn't everything. Yeah, I see a comment here saying overconfidence bias is the cause. Overconfidence bias at every level of control. Very sad. This is coming from Mr. Samuel Temitokwe. He says, I'm enjoying this now. Keep doing the great work. Thank you so much. Thank you for the encouragement. I appreciate you. Thank you for always having my back. I really do appreciate you. So I would keep going. I would keep going. So use the right raw materials for whatever type of job that you are doing. Never be too confident that you have this. According to Mr. Samuel Temitope, he said overconfidence. Overconfidence will make you want to cut corners. Overconfidence will make you want to prioritize excellence. Sorry, prioritize profit over excellence. So that's another learning. Make excellence your watchword and use the raw materials for your job. If excellence is your watchword, you will be on top of your game. Whether you are an employee in the office, you know, this construction thing also, if you are in the procurement department in your organization, if you are under projects, whatever department you are in, safety, you need to ensure that people, as somebody that is in safety, you need to ensure that people are using the right materials for the job. As somebody who is a project manager, you need to ensure that you are using the right tools on your job so that you don't, I mean, this is a whole cost. As a project manager, one of your jobs is cost management. So see, having killed a lot of people, all that you were trying to, you know, minimize by, I'm sure they were trying to cut costs by using, you know, inferior materials. All the costs that they were trying to cut has landed them in this situation. And at the end of the day, this is more cost. More cost to the organization, more cost to the government, more cost to the country, more cost to families. So really, money isn't everything. Profit isn't everything. Yes, cash is king. But sometimes we need to prioritize excellence over profitability. Although we know we have to stay profitable. I mean, work within your budget and make sure you deliver what you are expected to deliver. I also heard that they went ahead of, they tried to put more floors higher than what was originally approved for them. So this is you trying to make more profit over excellence. It's just so sad. It's so sad that so many lives were lost. For me, another thing I see here is corruption. Corruption is a killer. I repeat, corruption is a killer. Yes, Femi, you said something. You said, certainly it's not good to cut corners. Money isn't everything. Thank you for your comment. I appreciate that. I appreciate that. So we'll move on to the next point. Corruption is a killer. In one of my videos, I think the previous video I uploaded on YouTube, you know, I talked about a lady that came into Nigerian airport for the first time from America, and she was complaining about the corruption, about everything going on. She was really upset. She was really upset how they were, you know, asking her for money and all of that. And I talked about how corruption has gotten eaten in so deep. In this situation, I hear that the agents, the building agencies came in, the necessary authorities, they came in, they did their inspection. And after approval, they came in and they said, look, this is substandard materials being used. this is not according to what we have approved. And then they sealed up the place for a couple of months. Now, after it was sealed up, from what I read online, I hear that they restarted work. How will they restart work on a building that has been inspected and it was sealed up for one reason or the other? What would have warranted them resuming operations if not that somebody has been bribed? If not that somebody has been bribed, what would have warranted them to start operations again? And we can see now a lot of people are dead. Even the owner of the business, he's dead. So many people that shouldn't have been there in the first place, they are now dead. So what are we talking about? Corruption really is a pandemic. In Nigeria, it is. It is killing the country. It is killing the people. It is killing all the processes in organization. It is killing, eating. It's going in so deep. And we need to be very, very, very careful about it. It is a killer. A lot of people will say, everybody is corrupt. So if everybody is doing it, why can't I do it? Why should you do it? If excellence is your watchword, you will not want to cut corners. Neither would you want to give bribes. So corruption in itself is a killer. I also hear another lesson is, I also hear that, you know, there was this, they prayed on the building. You know, there was prayers and songs of praises that was, you know, done before or maybe while they were building. One lesson I learned here is that prayer without work is futile. I repeat, prayer without work is futile. If you pray from now till tomorrow and you do not do the right thing, I can promise you that you will not get the right results. Prayer without work is futile. I hear that people went into the building and they were, you know, praying and singing songs. We need to come out from the mindset, from that mindset that if I pray, everything is okay. I'm not saying prayer doesn't work. It works. Let prayer do its part. Then you do your part. If you're asking God to help you, you too help yourself. God will not help you if you don't move. God wants to see you move. Then all your prayers and your praises will all crown up towards success. Let me share this video with you. You might be wondering why is she saying this? Why is she saying this? Let me share this video with you.
If you look at me, I've not really been in Nigeria, so I'm not a Niger person. So I said, let me come back and do something.
Oh no, that's the wrong video. I guess that's the wrong video. But as time goes on, I would find the right video. What I'm trying to say here is prayer without work is futile. It is futile. If you are watching me for the first time, this is Femi's Place. Please do share this video, share, and drop your comments in the comment section. If you are also watching the replay of this live, please do drop your comments. I want to hear from you. I want to hear from you. And as time goes on, if you want to also contribute on this live, please signify, let me know, and I will bring you on live. So let's move on to my next point. The next point I have here is never, ever compromise on safety of any project. Never compromise on the safety of any project. Even in your home, on your jobs, in your businesses. Never compromise on the safety of any project. Safety is key. If I ask how many of us have, what do they call it now? Fire extinguishers in our homes. People will be looking at me like, what is she saying? Never compromise on safety of any project. Even in your business, what are those things? What are those things that could cause safety issues? Never ever compromise on them. Looking at what has happened with this Ikoyi building collapse, we see so many people gone just because safety was compromised. Safety was compromised. And compliance was not ensured. If you are a safety person, whether you are the head of the safety department or the head of a business, the head of your home, the head of any project, always ensure that people are compliant to the laws of the land, to the regulations, to what your visions are. Always ensure compliance at all times. An organization like this would have had rules, you know, steps, what we need, what we are expected to do on any project. Never compromise on safety of any project. Compromise of safety, unsafety is what has led to loss of property, loss of life. Life is more important. Never compromise on safety. Another learning that I got from this Ikoyi building collapse is make risk management your lifestyle. Make risk management your lifestyle. I repeat, make risk management a lifestyle. In your business, make risk management a lifestyle. In your organization, make risk management a lifestyle. In your home, make risk management a lifestyle. You might be wondering, what's she talking about? Well, what is risk management all about? It is simply you looking at the unseen, foreseeing what could happen to destroy your objectives. What is the objective? The objective in this situation is, okay, we want a high-rise building. That is the objective. A high-rise building that can take so capacity of people, that will stand the test of time. When you start your project, what are those things that can hinder your objectives? Even in your personal lives, on your personal goals, what are those things that can hinder your objective? If you make risk management your lifestyle, you will always have a plan B. If you make risk management your lifestyle, you will always, always, always be prepared for emergencies. You will always be prepared. You will think ahead. You will be a visionary. You'll be able to look at your situation and say, what could happen? What might happen? If I do this like this, what do I stand to lose? I am not sure. In this Ikoyi building collapse, I'm not sure if they did a thorough risk management. And if they did, some leaders don't even go by the risk management report. Some of them just say, oh, everything is going to be fine. Everything is going to be okay. Everything will not be okay if you don't do the right thing. Even in your life, you have your goals. You have your objectives. What are those things that could hinder your objectives? What are those things that could set you back? Then you begin to make plans. What are my plans to mitigate this risk? Is this a risk that I can live by? Is this something that would you know, could erode my profitability, could erode my reputation, could erode my person, could erode my business as a whole? This is the work of risk management. If their risk management was done very rightly, maybe through their project management or through their safety, if it was done rightly and it was adhered to and there was compliance to it, I do not think that we will lose as many lives as we have lost today. I do not even think that any life would be lost. It's just so sad. It's just a pity that, you know, in Nigeria, we are yet to really, really understand the importance of risk management. It permeates every aspect of your life. If you are watching this on the replay, please put your comment in the comment section. I would love to hear from you. Let's go to the comment section and see what people are saying before I continue. I have a comment here. It says, Femi Bobrade, yes, corruption is a killer. The earlier we check it, the better for our nation and our social economic development. I agree with you 101%. Corruption is eating deep. Look at our GDP today. Look at the inflation rate. Look at all our micro and macroeconomic indicators. All of these, we can sit down and begin to analyze, you know, the reports, the financial report of Nigeria. We can go to the CBN and begin to look at it and begin to make analysis. But the truth is, Yoruba people say, "Bo se joko lo ma se barai." That means the way you sit is the way you meet yourself. All that is in our reports as a nation is as a result of each and every one of us, our decisions and our indecisions. There's another comment here from Samuel Temitope. In fact, the answer to prayer in action and actions require clarity. I really don't understand that. Maybe you want to explain further. I would look at this other comment. In fact, the answers to prayers are in actions. Exactly, exactly. And actions require clarity of analysis or be informed by, and God bless you. I appreciate this comment, Mr. Samuel Temitope. You're my mentor. I respect that comment. Please don't analyze or think things. People don't analyze or think things through. Why? Because of overconfidence. Yes. That is, he felt, okay, if I have done it in other countries, I have done it here, then I should be able to do it in Nigeria. That was overconfidence. He was not looking at the situation, maybe the foundation of the building. He was not looking at that. He was not looking at the safety concerns. He was not even looking at, you know, the economic impacts of its inactions or actions. Yeah, it makes people have objections above the truth. They underestimate risk and overestimate their own unfounded, invalidated, and unverified knowledge. I agree with this comment 100%. 100%. We always underestimate risk. Oh, I did it here. I did it there. I beg, forget. I can live with it. Sometimes you cannot live with some things. Sometimes some things just have fatal implications. So I will move on. Thank you, Mr. Temitope Samuel, for that comment. I will move on now. I said earlier, make risk management your lifestyle. Another thing I would like for us to understand is whenever you are making decisions, consider yourself and others when making decisions. If you decide to cut corners, on your job, you know, this video, really, this life is, it permeates every aspect of our lives. It's talking to everyone, every employee in an organization, whether you are the boss, whether you are the floor member, it is talking to every one of you. Even in families, whether you are the head of the family or you are the child in the family, it is talking to you. This video permeates every aspect of our lives so that we don't have a situation where we are saying, oh, sorry, oh. At the end of the day, we want to prevent, you know, shedding tears. So to make sure everybody is carried along, consider yourself and others when making decisions. One man's decision or one man's indecision has led a lot of people, or let me say a group of people's decisions. But at the end of the day, whether it's a group of people, there is one person that's at the end of approvals. Okay, this is the direction that we should go, and this is the direction we shouldn't go. So there is one person at the end of the decision-making tree. Consider yourself and others when making decisions. Why do I say so? Mr. Femi Osibana didn't consider a lot of things. He didn't put a lot of things into perspective. And now, he didn't even consider himself. Now, he's gone. May his soul rest in perfect peace. And so many lives, 30-something lives and still counting, are dead. Let's consider ourselves and other people when we are making life-changing decisions, when we are making business decisions, life-impacting decisions. Consider yourself and others when making such decisions. If you are watching this on the replay, please give this video a thumbs up, share, and put on your notification bell so that you'll be notified whenever I want to go live and whenever I post new videos. So let's move on real quickly. I have talked about corruption is a killer. I said prayer without work is futile. I said use the right materials for your jobs. Never cut corners. And I also said make risk management your lifestyle. Some losses can be avoided. Especially this one. Some losses can be avoided. Especially this one. We didn't have to lose all these lives. We didn't have to lose all these people. Femi Osibana, or the copper, and you know, all these people that are still being looked for shouldn't have been in these situations. Families shouldn't have been in these situations. Losses, loss of property, loss of money, loss of credibility, loss of lives should have been avoided if we have done the right thing. Another area I want to talk about is I see people talking about the workers, the people trying to rescue people, that they are not doing the right thing, that they don't even know what they're supposed to do. They don't even know the equipment that they're supposed to use to actually find people. Let us always invest in best practices. If we are innovative enough, we invest in best practices, we do researches, it will equip us for emergencies like this. And we wouldn't lose so much. You know, I heard of the sister of a particular guy. She was saying, look, there are some people that are still alive in all of the leftover of the building. They are buried in there. Some of them are still breathing, which is true. But if we as a nation, we have a good response to emergency, we wouldn't be losing so many lives. If we as a nation are taking safety, made it a priority, we wouldn't be losing so many lives. If we as a nation have taken our people as priority and as government parastatals, they have trained their employees to respond to emergencies, we wouldn't be losing so many lives at this time. Some losses are actually avoidable if we do the right things. Instead of thinking about the monies that will come into our pockets, instead of thinking about, you know, how to make ourselves rich, how to make ourselves more powerful. If we think about the common good of our nation, today we wouldn't be talking about so many losses. Today, corruption wouldn't have eaten so deep. And lastly, above all, what do you want to be remembered for? As a human being, what do you want to be remembered for? Look at Femi Osibana of Osibono. When people hear that name now, the first thing they think about is Ikoyi building collapse. What do you and I, because as I speak to myself as well. What do we want to be remembered for when we are no more here? How do we want people to talk about us? When we think about what we want to be remembered for, I am very, very sure that this would motivate us to want to be the best versions of ourselves. It's just so sad. It's so sad that we had to lose so many people. Let me go back to the comment section. I think I have a comment from someone. There's a comment from Oluwaseyi Ifelaja. Before we conclude on this construction calamity, have we heard directly from the company as to what they feel is the cause of the problem? I believe we are all on social media. I believe we all listen to the news. And I believe that investigations are still being done. I hear the governor of Lagos State has said he has set up a panel for investigations to be carried out. So we cannot just conclude yet, you're very right. But we have lessons to learn from this, from what we have heard so far, from what we have read so far. Something didn't go right. And these are things that I think, these are my thoughts, as we wait on the investigations from the Lagos State government. Hopefully, the result of the investigations will come out soon, and we all will be here, you know, to also look at it, analyze it, and see how, you know, contribute, what we can learn from this company. At some point, I think we'll have to take the company as a life study, so we learn from these things. These are safety issues. These are, you know, life issues, you know. I mean, if you say yes, we cannot conclude, but we have lives here. People's life matter. You know, we are dealing with lives, and we need to sensitize the public. People need to understand. We have a lot of individuals into real estate that are not actually taking precaution. Real estate is a big industry that needs to take safety and risk management very, very important. If they do that, I don't think we will have a lot of houses being flooded. I don't think we will have a lot of houses collapsing. I still heard that there was one that collapsed in Lekki recently. Let's see this other comment. It's insane for someone to invest so much into a project and then use inferior product. That's the news we are hearing. Could the owner be responsible, or sabotage came in? Okay, so to respond to this question, it could be sabotage, and the owner could be I would hold the owner responsible. If sabotage is coming in, it could be coming in from the workers, from the people that he has put in position of authority. Now that speaks to me, that tells me that his employment, his selection process is faulty. I mean, if a company has its core values and rules that they stand by, these rules will govern the kind of people that you employ into your organization. So yes, the owner I hold responsible. Sabotage, yes, there could be sabotage at some point and at somewhere or the other. Yes, sometimes the owner might be, yes, it might have, might be someone that has integrity and everything, but there are some people that are put in place of authority within the organization that might be cutting corners just to have some kind of money in their pocket. And that is where corruption comes in. That is where excellence comes in. So yes, to an extent, I hold the owner responsible, because if he has internal audits regularly, he would have been able to see some things, some irregularities in his organization. The leader should be held responsible at all times. Like I would always say, we are always shouting, Buhari, Buhari, Buhari. You and I, yes, we are a reflection of Buhari. So sometimes the actions that your employees take is a reflection of the leader. Sometimes corruption, lack of risk management culture, lack of safety culture is the tone from the top that trickles down and brings out all of this. Yes, I will blame the owner. He should be held responsible, but unfortunately, he is dead. So at this point, I would say, please drop your comments, continue to drop your comments. And yes, thank you for all, everyone that has, you know, commented on this video. Thank you for the likes. Please, I need more likes on this video. If you're watching me on YouTube, please, I need more likes on this video. Drop in your comments in the comment section. I will be able to see it. And I'm happy that I am finally able to have a hand on, you know, my live streaming. Finally, and coincidentally, it happened at this time. So I intend to go live maybe once a week on different topics that, you know, affect our lives, current issues, life experiences. But I want us to take away from this video that risk management is a must in our daily lives, in our businesses, in everything that we do, in everything that we say. Excellence should be a watchword in our lives. Corruption is a no-no. Corruption eats deep. Corruption is what has gotten Nigeria to where it is today. Let's say no to corruption, please, my people. Let's say no to corruption. It is a killer. It has claimed so many lives. It has killed our economy. It is killing people day in, day out. It is hurting our pockets. It's killing our jobs. Oh, please, let's say no to corruption. And prayer without works is futile. As you pray, work. God wants to see you in action as well, so he can bless your actions with an answer to your prayers. Thank you for listening to me. I just thought I should share my two cents on this collapse, this Ikoyi building collapse. If you're watching on the replay, please do give us your comments as well. For those people who don't know me, my name is Femi Ayodele. I'm your sister in transformation. And I, on my YouTube channel, I have a YouTube channel. You can go check it out. If you are on Facebook, you can go check it out. It is also called Femi's Place. Please share your thoughts. Subscribe to my YouTube channel. Like this video, share, drop your comments in the comments section. I want to make these lives as interactive as possible. And as time goes on, I would make sure I am able to bring people on to share their thoughts and their beliefs, or what they think on the subjects that I discuss. So thank you for being here. Thank you for the comments. Ife Laja, I see you. Mr. Samuel Temitope, thank you so much. Your words have been encouraging. Oh, my sister, thank you so much. Thank you. I appreciate you, Sister Nena. I really, really appreciate you. Thank you all. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Femi Bobo Ade. You have been so consistent on my Facebook page. I really appreciate you. I do not take you all for granted. Thank you, everyone that commented. And hopefully, we are able to create a community where we are able to share our thoughts and, you know, learn from it, and with the aim of becoming the best versions of ourselves. Thank you so much. I would have to end this live broadcast here. I hope to come on live sometime during the week. My live sessions might be once a week. I need to decide. Thank you all. Thank you so much. And yay, finally, I am able to have a hang on my live videos. And with this, I want to say, give a shout out to all the families that have lost people on this Ikoyi building collapse. Let's just, before I end this video, let's just do a 1 minute silence for all those who lost their lives in this tragedy. May their souls, may the soul of the departed ones rest in perfect peace. Amen. Have a good day, friends. I'll see you next in my next video. Bye. Bye, everyone. Bye-bye.